So who of you are programmers or have been working as programmers? Okay, who of you are familiar with Python, Java, Scala, R? Okay, who of you could, you don't have to, who of you could explain an artificial neural network in front of the audience? One, two, okay, good. Who of you are architects? Who of you are neither of those, like business decision makers? Okay. Whenever I'm talking about something and you don't understand it, please raise your hand. And if you are feeling bored as well, so I try to make this talk in order to comply with all your backgrounds. So it's about IoT today and it's about artificial intelligence methods. So I'm calling deep learning and neural networks as artificial intelligence methods, and you will actually see today how we can do this. And I will also type a lot, so that means I don't know how I will manage that with that microphone, but anyway I have a second microphone, so that audio goes to the YouTube channel. So I'm working for the IBM Watson IoT division, which is headquartered in Munich, which was founded this year, and we already have around 6,000 clients where we are working with, and it's a $200 million investment for IBM. And here you see a list of partners where we are running POCs or projects, or we partner with hardware vendors like Cisco and Intel and so on, Texas Instruments. And why is IBM thinking IBM should invest in IoT? So as you can see here, a lot of IoT devices will be deployed on the planet, and all those devices are generating data. So it's a very interesting case for artificial intelligence methods. All those devices are connected to the cloud somehow. That's our vision. And I will now introduce you to the, let's say, the backbone or central nervous system of IoT, how to acquire data in just 5 to 10 minutes. And then we will dive into the machine learning part, okay? So it's all about MQTT. And MQTT provides a system which is called the MQTT Message Broker, and you can publish and subscribe data. So the devices, those are either IoT gateways, like Intel Edison, Raspberry Pi, or Cisco has some gateways, and the gateway has some sort of internet connection. And there are also devices which are only sensors or actors without internet connections. They are connected to a gateway. Or of course there exist hybrids with both of those functionalities. And out of the box we provide around 250 connectors for different sorts of devices. And since everything runs on MQTT, you can basically hook up everything to that message broker, even a smartphone. And since it's after lunch and I thought a bit of sports would be nice, in about 5 to 10 minutes we will run a little demonstration and you can actually participate with your smartphone and generate data, and we will analyze it. Very simple one, but just to get, just as a warm-up exercise, mentally and physically. So that's basically the core of it. And we stay compatible with any other competitors because it's all about MQTT. You can even, I have an MQTT message broker on my laptop. It's called Mosquito. So when I'm in a plane, I don't have Wi-Fi and I want to play around, I just start a local one. That's the cool thing about using open standards. You need some APIs for managing devices, of course, and security. And the important thing is the analytics on top of it. We provide some out-of-the-box analytics, but we want to be open to any algorithm, framework, programming language, whatever you can imagine. And I'm actually showing you how to use a system installed on my laptop in order to get the data and process it. So that's an example how to connect the Raspberry Pi to that platform. This is Python code. For those who know Python, it's obvious. And it's also obvious that you need only 3 lines of code to read a temperature value from a sensor, reformat it, and publish it. And quality of service equals 2 means that you have guaranteed exactly once end-to-end delivery, and the platform is capable of doing fault tolerance and failover, and it basically is installed on many of the IBM data centers. So you don't have to care about that. If you want to know how to do that, there's a Coursera course, which my colleagues are teaching. And I have another Coursera course, if you're interested, which I'm teaching. It's about the basic analytics. So how to get data into a NoSQL database and analyze it using Apache Spark. Okay. And it basically ends where it starts to get interesting. It ends with principal component analysis to reduce the dimensions of your input. And as we will see today, there are better dimension reduction techniques. Those are called autoencoders. I will explain those later. And they are based on neural networks. And we will actually use it in the demonstration. So that's enough about the central nervous system of IoT. Now, more interesting is, of course, if we are at the AI summit in London, to talk about the brain of IoT. So machine learning comes in two flavors. You have machine learning, batch type machine learning on historic data, and you have online learning. When I'm talking about IoT, of course, I want to take real-time data into account, stream data, and actually those have pros and cons. So the most important ones are in online learning, if you don't store the data, you don't pay for the storage. And that's an important pro because storage can get quite expensive. I have a use case where we store live EEG data from a couple of patients in a hospital, and we store it for 10 years and it comes to roughly $500,000. Okay? And some cons are that out of the box, the algorithms don't necessarily support incremental data processing. And therefore, the software available for doing incremental data processing is also not there. And if you come up with a better algorithm, you have lost the data. You cannot rerun it. Okay, so that's the con. And the pro on the batch processing, of course, all the algorithms are supported, because if you invent an algorithm for machine learning, then you start with batch processing. That's the usual thing. And therefore, abundance of software exists, scikit-learn for Python, R, Apache Spark, and also commercial software packages like SPSS and SAS and so on. And if you come up with a better idea, better algorithm, then you just rerun your job and you have a better model. And one con of the online I forgot to mention is your compute power has to be in line with the data arrival rate. You will see that later in my demonstration. I'm running an artificial neural network on my laptop, and it can't cope with a sample rate of 100 hertz, where I'm reading sensors at the sample rate of 100 hertz. So I'm doing some tricks, but that's an issue. There's the cloud, so you can scale up and down. That's one thing, but you have to pay for the resources as well. A con of historic data processing, as I mentioned, you have high storage costs. Even if you can throw away a lot of data, you still have to pay for the storage. And sometimes you've thrown away data which would have been of use. Sometimes you never know what data you should retain. And the other thing is your model, which you are training, is only updated after the batch. So it's not good for low latency reaction or low latency model updates. And you can somehow sort of combine those two in order to pull the best out of both. So, I asked a lot of questions before. I didn't ask about your mathematical background. So, who of you have a mathematical background? Okay, perfect. Wow. So, what is this? Any thoughts? Wow. Yeah, correct. That's the first time in my life. I'm doing this presentation a lot. You will see that on my YouTube channel. But it's the first time out of the box so many saw that this is ARIMA. A lot of people see that it's linear. A lot of people see that it's a regression model, but very nice. Okay, have you heard about that term most likely? Deep learning? So have you heard about time series analytics using deep learning? Not before. It's hard to find publications. You have? Okay. I found three. So we can discuss later. If you found the fourth one, please let me know. I think I have two or three of them in a slide, so you can compare. So that means either it doesn't work or nobody is using it. And I have the feeling nobody is trying it because everybody is like sucked in that visual recognition and natural language processing things, and they completely forget about structured data. And it comes a bit with Apache Spark. As you see here, those are Google Trend Charts, and they are kind of correlating. You also see that the spike of Spark is over. Who of you is using Apache Spark in production or just for playing? Yeah, okay. And deep learning, we don't know, but it's still growing. But I show you how you can do deep learning on Spark, so you have solved both problems. So actually, you told me you won't be able to explain an artificial neural network in front of the audience. Are you still convinced that is true? Because then I will just start from the beginning. Your decision? Shall I? Yeah? Okay. If you suffer, it's your fault, okay? So, okay, then let's have this hypothetical data set. It's from an Industry 4.0 use case, basically, where you monitor some sensor data from something, a motor or a bearing or whatever, and then you have an outcome, 0 and 1. 1 is faulty, 1 is healthy. And if you have to write a rule for that data, what would you implement? It's a very simple one-liner rule. Yeah. Okay, good. So, that you have learned by looking at the data. You can't, of course, do that if you have millions of rows and hundreds of columns, hundreds of features. But then you could at least use this one. Most likely you know what this is. Yeah, linear regression. And the idea here is to train and learn A, B, C, and D. So can you tell me A, B, C, and D for that data set? Slightly more complicated. You can tell me also one single variable, one single parameter if you have an idea of one. Yeah, 100 is nice. And D? D basically is -1/3412. That works pretty well. So what do you do if you want to turn this into a binary classifier? Yeah? Yeah. Sigmoid, you squash it between a range between 0 and 1. So it takes minus infinity to plus infinity and squashes it to a range of between 0 and 1, and then you define a threshold, and then you have a binary classifier. And that's basically a good start for understanding how a artificial neural network works, because it's kind of a stacked, multiple stacked logistic regression models. If you are using the sigmoid activation function, in a neural network, you can change this. So what you see here is the input of a single neuron. It has x1 to n. Those are the input values. And it has w1 to n. Those are the weights or the parameters of the logistic regression model. You have a transfer function, which is sum in this case. I've never seen anything else than sum in my life. And then you have an activation function. If you are coming from logistic regression, you have sigmoid, but in neural networks, you use TunH, rectifier, and a lot of others. And those are basically part of the hyperparameter set of the model, which is basically a pain, but I will come to this later. I mean the large hyperparameter space. And in contrast, it's this bit the same like in the brain. This is one single neuron where you have the actual neuron, that's the cell. The dendrites are the inputs, and then the axon just goes to the next neurons. And between the neurons, that's the most interesting part, those are the synapses. And the synapses are parameterizable connections between neurons in the brain, but those are biochemical. And since they are biochemical, so they use neurotransmitters to actually transmit the data. And since they are biochemical, they can be modulated. Okay, that's maybe an interesting idea for future artificial neural networks, because those are not taking that property into account. And yeah, basically, then you stack those together, then you get an ordinary feedforward neural network with a single layer. And the idea now is by adding additional hidden layers to create automatically abstractions of your data. Okay. Until now, who knew all this before? One, two. Oh, nice. So I'm not boring you at all, maybe, no? Hopefully. So if we now continue with that, we can implement such a neural network very easily. Of course, there exist libraries, no worries, but you can implement such a neural network very easily because you can reformulate the linear regression model using a vector matrix, no, in this case a vector-vector multiplication. So linear regression model is nothing else or can be expressed as a multiplication between two vectors. One vector are the parameters and one vector are the input data. And then you squash it using sigmoid, as you can see here, and then you have calculated a single neuron. You can even more facilitate things if you are using matrix vector multiplication, because then you can compute multiple neurons at the same time, which is then basically you compute a layer. Okay. And if you then add a second layer, as you can see here, layer 2 takes the input of layer 1. So it's nothing else than stacking the models behind each other in a feed-forward network case. Yeah, actually, I think that's a duplicate. Anyway, and yeah, as I said, you can add additional hidden layers. You get further abstractions and you learn the abstractions of your data. And later on, I will show you an example where the automatically learned feed-forward layer was outperforming fast Fourier transformation. Who doesn't know what fast Fourier transformation is? What is discrete Fourier transformation? It's a transformation from the time domain into the frequency domain. So if you have a time signal and you apply FFT, you basically get all the frequency components, the spectrum of the signal. And the neural network is capable of learning such a transformation or even outperforming such a transformation by just adding simple feed-forward layers, which is quite interesting. And then we have the convolutional neural networks. Maybe those are more familiar to you, because I think half of those are of those stents are on visual recognition and chatbots and that stuff, no? It's also inspired by the human brain. The human brain does exactly the same. In the first layers, if you see my face, the first layer only sees rectangles and lines and circles. And the further you go down the layers, the more concrete those neurons fire on specific things it sees, okay? And then at the end, at the last layer, you basically can detect faces, cars, elephants, and chairs in that example. You can do some art if you like. So that thing is called neural style. It's not my invention. So those are the images from the author. And it's actually that neural style is written in a framework called Torch with a programming language called Lua. I've looked at that and I said, oh my God. Luckily, it was already prepared so I could run it. And then a startup in Switzerland where I'm based on is commercializing this in a B2C model, running on the IBM cloud on the GPU instances. So you can upload the image and apply a style and download the image. You get it for free if you wait a day. And if you want to have it now, you pay $2. If you want to have a post-op, then it's $25. That's the idea. But the key thing about a feed-forward deep neural network is that it can learn any mathematical function. If you have enough data, and if you have enough good data, and if you have enough computing power. There's one famous publication, I forgot it, but I can search a link for you if you like. Representable doesn't always imply learnable. So if you have a very cool model, but you haven't enough good data, you cannot learn it. Like my table with the three examples, you of course cannot learn anything great out of that, besides, let's say, linear regression. But the thing what I want to say is feedforward networks are bad at sequence data. And at Watson IoT, I'm dealing with sequence data. So what you can do here is to add feedback loops, and then you get a recurrent neural network. Have you heard about that term before? Okay, most. And that basically adds the time domain into your neural network. But it's limited. Basically, the amount or the number of layers limits the time steps the neural network can remember things. And to overcome this limitation, you can use LSTMs. Have you heard about LSTMs? Okay. LSTMs are long short-term memory networks. Have you heard about long short-term memory networks? Okay, some of you. It's hard to explain, but the abstract idea is that you add memory to the neuron and you have three additional inputs where you can trigger the time where it memorizes something, where it forgets something, and where it outputs the things which it has memorized. And then basically you can train the trigger of those three pipelines also with your data. And then you can do wonderful things with the LSTM. So for example, that's not my idea. You see the GitHub link below. It's quite old, 2015. You can train an LSTM with Shakespeare literature, and it can generate Shakespeare-like literature. And without knowing anything about grammar or English or sentences or Shakespeare, or with LaTeX code, and it creates LaTeX code. Maybe you have to do some post-processing to make it compile. Same holds for the Linux C kernel. I think that one could compile. I haven't spot anything, but I didn't try, but that would be an interesting thing. But anyway, doesn't make sense, of course, but it gives you a feeling of the power of those, no? I will not play that music created by the LSTM. It's pretty bad, but but the key thing is it outperforms state-of-the-art time series anomaly detection algorithms. Those are listed below, and you see here the green lines is normal behavior of different data sources like ECG and the engine space shuttle we have. The blue are anomalies which are not taught to the neural network. Only the blue signal is given to the neural network. The blue is only for us, okay? So the neural network is not aware. It's an unsupervised machine learning discipline. And the red lines, that's one over the reconstruction error of the model. That means the lower the red line gets, the less probable is it that the neural network has seen the data before. So that's pretty clear in the first example on the top left. I even can tell that on the top right, it's a bit more complicated. I might guess that the third spike is somehow abnormal, but then interestingly it can detect it completely. And what you also observe is that later on it thinks that it is normal. And what do you think, what's the reason for that? Yeah, exactly. It has learned the abnormal data and then turns this into normal data. So what you actually have to do is you have to do a second stage algorithm on the outputs of those reconstruction errors. And what you also might want to do is to regularly restore the model state that it forgets what it has seen. So those are two things in addition what you can control. So it's a nightmare because you have so many parameters anyway, and then you have additional parameters, but that's life. So the second discipline I'm currently working on is forecasting. And here in this paper, the state of the art was kernelized regression with a root mean squared error of 8.3%. And then, interestingly, the next one is a frequency neural network. Frequency neural network means they have used fast Fourier transformation before and basically fed in only the spectrum to the neural network, 6.7%. Then what I said before, they removed the FFT and just added additional feed-forward layers, and they outperformed FFT. So you can learn a better feature engineering, feature pre-processing using a neural network, given you have enough data. And the last one is the LSTM, and it's 2.8%. So those two publications inspired me, and I said, okay, if you want to be a good data scientist, first thing you do Coursera courses until you are fed up, or you take the Stanford machine learning course, and then every other course you take is just boring. But then it's, yeah, life becomes boring. And the second thing you can do is you can run Kaggle competitions. But it turns out Kaggle competitions are boring as well, because those guys who are winning, they have just enough money on their bank accounts, because they are running stacked and boosted models with neural networks and graded boosted trees. And then it's just fitting against the Kaggle test set to gain another 0.00001%. So also boring. And the third thing you can do is you can replicate papers. And that's what I'm currently doing. And I've replicated this one quite successfully, I think. So we'll see that later. And that's the key message about LSTMs. They are Turing complete. Anyone of you hasn't heard the term Turing complete? Okay, Turing complete means basically in theoretical computer science, a system which can basically run everything what you can run on a modern microprocessor, which is very promising. But as I already said, representable is not learnable, but the potential is there. One reason for the statement that representable is not learnable is the amount of CPU power you need. So this is an example, 2009. That's taken from the Google Brain. It's 1,000 nodes, 16,000 cores to recognize cats. And the neural network has not ever seen a cat before. And the same compute power you have in that GPU card. The NVIDIA guys are quite around the corner. And they have a new technology called NVLink. Just go there. I will go there later as well. And then you have ASICs, application-specific integrated circuits. And only two vendors on this planet have one. It's Google with a tensor processing unit, and it's IBM with the IBM 2 North. And that guy can run neural networks in silico. There's no clock, so data distributes on the wafer in a certain speed, mimicking the way the brain is doing it. And currently IBM builds a 4,000 chips cluster that has 4 billion neurons, 1 trillion synapses. In contrast, the human brain has 100 billion neurons and 1 trillion synapses. So it gets interesting. I told you a synapse is completely different than just a little weight parameter of a neural network, of course. And even there is research going on with the IBM supercomputer in Switzerland. It's called the Blue Brain Project. And they need around one laptop of compute power to simulate only one neuron. So it's completely different. But anyway, you see the size of those things, and those guys are cool, because you can put that on a smartphone. They are consuming only 4 watts maximum, or 3 watts, and they can do real-time object recognition. So one thing I'm currently looking into is recognize people on the street in your car and try to trigger automatic brake based on that, and based on a neural network. So now, as I promised, let's make something that you don't fall asleep. Let's do something that you don't fall asleep. And for those who want, you only need a smartphone and the internet connection. You don't have to install anything. You don't have to give any permissions to me or my app to suck in all your private data. Um, So this is not correct. Actually, this link here. Oh, she's scared. No, bro, you don't have to participate if you don't like. So if you have a QR code reader, just open this link or type it. It's ibm.biz/boom-boom-shake-shake. You will notice later why it is boom-boom-shake-shake. And what happens, app is opening. No, sorry, a website is opening, a mobile website, and it asks you for username and a password. Just type any 4-character lowercase string as your username and maybe the same as password. And then let's see what happens. So I will reopen the link again in a second. I just want to prepare something which I forgot to prepare before. But I'm getting better. Normally I'm totally unprepared. Now I have even all the tabs open I need. So what you see here is the Watson IoT platform user interface, which sits on top of that message broker, and the app or the mobile website you're running on your smartphone currently uses JavaScript to access the accelerometer sensors and sends that to the cloud using MQTT, all in JavaScript. So let's wait a bit. So anybody wants to participate, I will just give you the link again. Okay. If you need the link, just raise your hand. Otherwise, I will switch the screen again to this one. Okay. Yeah, I think that's a reasonable number of people. So what now happens is you already are creating data and sending that to the cloud. At least you should. I am not receiving anything now. Ah, now. So device 1234. Who is 1234? You. Okay. Can you shake for 1 second, please? Okay, that's enough. So you see here, that's one data point. And at that particular timestamp, you created 1.68 in direction of X, 3.37 in direction of Y, and 0.46 in direction of Z. That's the accelerometer value. We sample 10 times per second. And yeah, that's basically all. So if you want to win and you want to create a lot of energy, please remember you have to shake in all three dimensions. If you only shake like that, that's not enough because we will take the sum later. And now let's see what happens. So you should already see data coming in here. That's cool. And oh, by the way, that tool here is also very cool. It's called Node-RED. It's written in JavaScript. It's running on top of Node.js. It's written by IBM, but open sourced also by IBM. And we've given that to the JavaScript Foundation. It runs everywhere. It runs on a Raspberry Pi, on Intel Edison, in the cloud, on your laptop, and in other clouds in your data center. And even I think Intel is using it in their gateways and some other partners, so because it's open source now they can use it. Yeah, let's stream that data into a database. Yeah, you can shake later. I'm not recording. The database is Apache CouchDB. It's also a service in the IBM cloud. There are also others, MongoDB and whatever you need. But let's create this table, and I'm still not recording. So when I hit deploy, I will start recording. So I will stream that data into that NoSQL database, and let's record for around 10 seconds. And then I just cut this connection and redeploy, and then recording stops. Okay. And then we will see who of you created the most energy. Okay. 1, 2, 3, and go. Boom, boom, shake, shake. Boom, boom, shake, shake. Boom, boom, shake, shake. Boom, boom, shake, shake. I know who wins, maybe. Boom, 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 shake, shake. Boom, 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 shake, shake. Boom, boom, shake, shake. boom, boom, shake, shake, and stop. So if everything was running correctly, let's go. I will just show you how the data looks like. Anyone is using NoSQL, MongoDB, CouchDB, Redis? Okay. So I have to remember what I wanted to do. I wanted to show you the contents of the database now. You could use an ordinary Apache CouchDB client, but I have no clue how this works, so I'm using the web interface, which is proprietary for IBM, but no worries, you get the REST endpoint, so you can use any tooling. And while this loads, yeah, I'm struggling with some Scala code here, so let's get rid of that. And let's open that notebook. So there's my boom, boom, shake, shake notebook. So that's basically another IBM tool called Data Science Experience, based on Jupyter Notebooks and the Apache Spark service. It runs on top of it runs Scala, Python, and R code. So I've deleted the SQL statement because I want you to implement it later. But it's pretty straightforward. So we use now this UI to see if the data arrived. So hopefully it arrived. Otherwise, I have some backup data from previous sessions. So we have 894 documents. That sounds reasonable. And you see here, that's one document. Don't worry about the verboseness of JSON. Internally, it's stored in a binary form. And you see here, timestamp undefined as ID. Who is undefined? So you somehow managed to submit an empty. Some of you submitted an empty user ID. Anyway, you see here the accelerometer values and OA to OB and OG, those are the gyroscopes, but I'm not taking those into account. So if you want now to analyze that in a very, very easy fashion, what you do is you connect. To this NoSQL database, you obtain a data frame, and it's somehow similar to a pandas Python data frame or R data frame. But the cool thing is, if you load more data into the data frame than you have main memory, it doesn't crash. You can load 1 terabyte or 1 petabyte of data into a data frame in Apache Spark, nothing happens because it's lazy evaluation. It gets only processed once you issue a command against it. And the other thing is, that's basically the main thing. And it's running in parallel. So what I want now to do is to implement a little SQL statement in order to analyze this. So who of you is familiar with SQL? Who is brave enough to tell me what to type? Also, fractions of the statement are okay. You don't know what to do. I forgot.
Yeah.
So you have shaked your device and you have created energy, or you have used energy. And in order to approximate that energy you've created in that 10 seconds, so those are 3 time series, you could calculate the integral function of each of those 3 dimensions. That's the surface under the core, and that's the energy. That's not totally exactly the energy. One physicist was in my session once and told me it's a bit different, but it approximates it pretty well. And since we are sampling 10 times per second, we can approximate that integral, okay? If you just basically sum up the values, and they can also go into negative. So we have to also take the absolute value of those values, sum those all up by user ID, and then sum up all the 3 dimensions. Then you get the energy, and then we should order it by user ID, descending, that you get a Hall of Fame or high score list, okay? It's like one line of SQL code. So I'm open for suggestions. So, tell me the keyword every SQL statement begins with if you want to query data. Yeah. Okay, maybe we have to remove star, but I type it then. From database name. So it turns out you can register any data frame in Apache Spark with a temporary view. So it's, yeah, I'm disclosing where I was in on that date. But anyway, so what else? What a buy?
1-2.
1-2? What is 1-2?
1-2.
Okay. Okay, it's a long time ago since you wrote your last SQL statement, maybe. So there's one thing which is called aggregation and group by here. And since I want to take all data into account, I remove that where. Otherwise, of course, I could just read one window of time worth of 10 seconds. But in that case, I don't need where. So group by what? Excuse me? ID. So there's the schema. Basically, the schema is inferred from the source. That's the property of Apache Spark data frames. And the source is, in this case, a NoSQL database. So you have this underscore ID underscore revision from CouchDB. Then you have AX, AY, AC, double. That's great. You have ID string. That's great. And the rest you can forget. Timestamp you can also forget. So group by ID. What else? Let's have a look at star, maybe, because it won't run. I just show you that it doesn't compile. And it will say a couple of things. And the key thing it says that you can't use star in that context because you're grouping by ID. So you need an aggregation function in the select clause. Or you can only put fields which you are grouping on. Okay?
So,
not bad. Okay, since we have energy already defined, we can also order it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the exhibition will close at 4 p.m. At 4 p.m., please proceed to the conference sessions. The exhibition will be in breakdown at 4 p.m. Thank you.
That sounds scary, but you can stay with me because my session will take until 4:30, and in about 5 minutes, I tell you the deep learning stuff. Okay, just finish that SQL statement for me, please. So, order by.
Energy
descending. Okay, what else? So, now we have to calculate the energy. I told you it's the absolute value of the individual values and those summed up.
Sum
what? Yeah, you're good. Okay. So I just put the mic on the table for 1 second. Okay. Yeah, I think you got the point. So are we happy? I think to be NC 2003 compliant, the S is missing. So I guess this runs. Let's try. So that statement can now run on 1 KB of data or 1 PB. You don't have to change it. It's Apache Spark. And we have been talking too long. So in the background now, on Kubernetes, some Docker images are restaged in order to provide a cluster for us. So it takes a bit longer now. But I see here. The winner is João Pedro. Who is João Pedro? You are from Portugal?
Yeah.
Okay. Muito bom. So, congratulations. Are you expecting a prize? Hopefully not.
Is there a prize?
No, yeah, I have to check my backpack, most likely. By the way, today evening I'm running a meetup nearby at Shack 15, and I can offer you beer and pizza if you like as a prize, but for everybody. Okay, so let's go to the neural network stuff. Okay, I have one prototype running using deep learning for J. In a couple of weeks, I'm confident that I have a second prototype running on Apache System ML, which is also IBM invention but open sourced. It's an eminent research thing. 10 years of research is in it. It's a optimizer for machine learning. So you write R syntax and that gets compiled, and based on cost-based statistics on your data, it chooses an optimal execution plan for your matrix algebra, and that's very hot, and it runs on Apache Spark and also on any JVM. So you can basically score a model in the cloud on Spark and, no sorry, train the model on the cloud in Spark and score it on a Raspberry Pi or on a smartphone. So you will see that on my YouTube channel in 3 weeks, I promise, or four maybe. And the third thing I'm currently investigating on is Tensor Spark. It's TensorFlow on Apache Spark, which basically also is very promising. So let's see what performs best. And I have three very cool tools to compare with, but now it's only deep learning for J on my laptop. And let's tell you something about deep learning for J. So the core of deep learning for J is a tensor library. Who doesn't know what a tensor is? So tensor is basically everything. So a one-dimensional tensor is a scalar, a two-dimensional tensor is a matrix, a three-dimensional tensor is a tensor, three-dimensional tensor, and so on. And it's basically a linear algebra library like NumPy for Python. It's out of the box on a CPU, double as fast as NumPy. And you can run it on the vector units on modern CPUs. And you can run it on GPUs. In order to turn on a GPU, you only have to set one parameter, given you have a CUDA installation on your system, of course. Then it already uses GPUs in the background. If you have more than one GPUs, I think you have to specify how many of those you want to use. Pretty straightforward. And it is also running on top of Apache Spark by just changing one line of code. So in my demo, you will see the first line of code. So sorry, it's a bit of Java, old-fashioned, but it's like it is. So if you want to run the same neural network on Apache Spark in a parallel fashion, then you use the second line of code. That's all you need to do. And you have to create an instance of a training master. So the reason why you have to have a training master is that it uses the so-called Jeff Dean-style parameter averaging approach in order to train a neural network in parallel. Okay, what you can do is you can run the same neural network in parallel on different hyperparameters for hyperparameter tuning. That's old school. But you can also train the neural network in parallel, give each neural network instance on each node different data to train on. And then every now and then, you send all the learned parameters, those are all the W values, the weights of the neural network, to a central server, average them out and send them back. That's the way, and that's Jeff Dean's style parameter averaging, because Jeff Dean was the first guy coming up with that, and he has proven that it works pretty well. And deep learning for J is using that out of the box without you taking care of that. So my use case is also on vibration sensor data, accelerometer sensor data, attached to a hypothetical bearing, because I don't want to always take a bearing with me. And it's based on the Lorentz attractor model. It's a physical model. Lorentz was one of the founders of chaos theory. And that model basically is pretty handy because it's very simple to create and very complicated to understand. It's a chaotic model. If you change one parameter slightly, you have a completely different data set. And that plot, if you don't have seen that before, it's a so-called phase plot. and you can basically plot four dimensions in that. One is time, and then you have three additional dimensions, and the trajectory of that line is basically time, and then you see the three dimensions, and that's the typical pattern of a Lorentz model, and that basically oscillates between two semi-stable states, and it's very, very hard to predict, or impossible to predict when it oscillates, okay? And I'm using that for my test data, and I can detect anomalies on that, because I change one single parameter slightly, or I think three I'm changing, and then I get a complete different behavior. And more familiar, you are maybe more familiar with run charts or time series plots, so those are the three dimensions, and the x-axis is time, and you can also make out that two of them are correlating and also oscillating between two semi-stable states. That's the healthy version of the data set, and that's the broken version of the data set. You see more energy, and what would be an ordinary process of analyzing such a data set? Any ideas? Most simple one, maybe. Excuse me? Yeah, very good, very good. Very intelligent audience here. So that's the spectrum of the first, spectrum of the second, both analyzed using FFT. For those familiar with FFT, I've only used the sine components, not the cosine components, but that doesn't matter. And you see more frequencies present, and you see more energy, okay, more amplitudes, higher amplitudes. So now comes the most interesting thing after the fact that a feedforward neural network can represent any mathematical function, and after the fact that LSTM is Turing complete. Those are my little babies, the autoencoders, and those are non-linear dimension reduction algorithms. Have you used linear dimension reduction before? Okay, singular value decomposition principle component analysis. That's basically the same. The idea behind that is the same, but it's non-linear because you have nonlinear activation functions in your neural network, and therefore you have also nonlinear behavior in your dimension reduction. And the way how it works is relatively simple. You train it by showing the neural network the same input and the same output, well, the same data as input and output at the same time. And in the middle you have a bottleneck, so that's the reduced dimension, here in this case only two. And then the neural network tries to reconstruct what it sees on the left-hand side, on the right-hand side, going through that bottleneck. And that forces the neural network to forget or not learn any error or irrelevant data. So it will concentrate on the most relevant data. That's basically a dimension reduction because it should only retain important dimensions. And since it's nonlinear, you have no idea what those two dimensions mean, of course, but that doesn't matter. We will just use that whole thing in order to measure the reconstruction error. So if we give the neural network data, we not only train, we also measure the reconstruction error, which is somehow the square root of the sum of the errors, individual errors, okay? And that's basically all about theory. Let's run this. So first, I will proudly show you my Lorentz attractor model test data generator, which I've implemented on top of Node-RED in JavaScript, which is really simple. Don't be scared, because it's only those three lines of code. That's the Lorentz attractor model. The rest is all glue code, initialization, blah, 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 because I can switch the states here. And now I told you the computing power has to be in line with the processing power of your machine learning machine, which is only my MacBook Pro in this case. And therefore, I'm limiting the data set to 30 seconds worth of data, which is 3,000 samples, because I'm basically sampling with 100 hertz. So I'm defining that here. It's every 100th of a second I send a message, and that will basically step that model one step forward and create the data. Sending that data via MQTT to the IBM Watson IoT platform. Also getting it here again just for debug. And whenever I hit reset, like a wall gets reset and 30,000 tuples go through, okay? And I have this implemented in Java now on my laptop, and I will show you briefly how this works. So I told you, who can read that? Okay, the first line, maybe. First row, maybe. So give me 1 second, let's put the mic back. We have still half an hour. So.
Try Command Plus on the end.
Excuse me?
Command Plus on the end to like this.
Yeah. It's okay, I... Ah, yeah. You see, I've done that before. but it's always hard to find it again. So now it's so big. So that's the multi-layer configuration. And I told you there are tons and tons of hyperparameters. Just to name a few, there's the AdaGrad, you can Google for AdaGrad. That's the global activation. It's ReLU in this case, you can use Sigmoid, you can also define the activation per layer or per neuron if you like. Per neuron, I'm not sure, but at least per layer. The optimization algorithm, you have to train it, and that's in this case stochastic gradient descent. Learning rate is a very important parameter. Regularization is very important to prevent overfitting. Also L2 and L1 you can set. And then you have the possibility of adding layers. So at index 0, I'm now using an LSTM layer with 3,000 input neurons and 3,000 output neurons. Then a dense layer with 3,000 input neurons and 2 output neurons. So that's my bottleneck. And then again the output layer with 2 input neurons and 3,000 output neurons of the layer. So I'm basically doing what I've shown you before, just in Java instead as a slide. And then all I need to do is basically call fit. And you see here features and labels. You don't see it here, but you have to trust me. Features and labels are the same data. And then it gets trained. So let's actually run this. So I have hooked up this via MQTT to the platform, and it just uses, I will explain that later, but while it runs, because it takes time anyway. So lucky we have still enough time. So let's run this. So first, Deep Learning 4J initializes the neural network. You see that here. I have 8 cores on my laptop. And it uses BLAST, that's the library. So I'm using already the vector processing unit on the CPU I have, but no GPU. I have a GPU in here. I could use it, but I haven't managed to get that CUDA crap running on the laptop. Excuse me?
Well, the graphics card on MacBooks is an AMD card. It's not an NVIDIA. CUDA is exclusive for NVIDIA. It's a fact.
Thank you. I love you. You have won 2 prizes. That's the reason. Yeah, definitely. No, I will offer you something later. That's the reason. Okay. Okay, I have to check on that. Yeah, perfect. Yeah, because I didn't manage it. That's the reason why. Okay, but 8 cores at least, 10 GB of memory I'm occupying. So that's that black stuff, and the red stuff is on system R, the connection to the MQTT message broker. So I'm using the IBM library here, but I could use the MQTT library as well. It's just for comfort, because less lines of code. And now we are waiting. It's a main thread, and every, I don't know, 100,000 iterations, it just spills out this debug message here. So when I now start this test data generator by just hitting reset and setting the counter to 0 again, you see here, waiting for tumbling window to fill. And in stream processing, there's this notion of windows, also in time series analytics on batches, but always in stream processing, there's this notion of windows, and the windows has 2 dimensions. It can either be tumbling or sliding, and it can either be count-based or time-based. And tumbling means it fills up and then spills out all the data and waits for the next batch to fill. And sliding just is a FIFO, it's just a linear buffer. And then count-based is obvious, and time-based is maybe also obvious, it's just a period of time, but then of course you have to have a timestamp in your data. But in this case, it's a tumbling count-based window. It waits for...
Ladies and gentlemen, the exhibition is now closed. Please proceed to the conference sessions. The exhibition is now closed. And only exhibitors breaking down their stand should remain in the exhibition. Thank you.
And Romeo and his audience can stay until 4:30. Okay, you see here, that's the neural network, the autoencoder LSTM neural network, which is currently learning. So it uses stochastic gradient descent at each iteration to learn, and it prints out the reconstruction error, which fortunately goes down. And that's something really, really hard to achieve. So it depends on the topology of the neural network and of all the hyperparameters, and you need to have a convex or at least a descending function of the error, otherwise it oscillates or goes up and you're very frustrated. And what you then do in the case of deep learning for J, I have to mention that guy. There's a guy called Adam Gibson, who is the brain behind deep learning for J, and he's 24/7 on Jitter. So you can add questions to, and there are some other nerds, they are never sleeping. They try to help you, but it's basically like Andrew Ng from Stanford said, black magic. Okay, so I have done a lot of black magic during night times, and now I have a neural network which basically the reconstruction error decreases. If I do the same thing again, it will further decrease. So we stopped at 4,000 around. 4,000 of, it's not a normalized measure. It's just the overall squared sum of errors, and it, the more neurons you have, the higher it will get. You could normalize it by dividing it by the number of neurons, maybe. Or you can then squash it to sigmoid, and then you maybe get a normalized form. But anyway, that's not so important. So we have now the second round of training. And since we are always training, we continue to learn. Okay, and another 5 seconds to go. So it's 100 hertz. 100 messages per second. And the phase of the data is different. So it was, you have seen it was starting around 10,000, but then it went directly down because the data was already seen. So okay, 157. Now let's do the switch and switch to broken. I hope it was unhealthy before. Otherwise, we have. We will make.
Gentlemen, the exhibition is now closed. That. Please proceed to the conference sessions. Stream A is running. Please proceed there for closing plenary sessions.
Five minutes. Let's click on reset again, and if that reconstruction error goes down further, then I haven't switched it back to healthy before, and if it is more than 157 at the end, then I was doing it correctly. Yeah?
I didn't quite understand one thing. Why would the error sometimes grow for a while?
Because it's an LSTM. A LSTM is capable of understanding the sequence of data. And if I reset the Lorentz attractor model, I'm basically changing the phase of the data. And then it takes a while.
It's also new data, right?
It's new data. And also it's yeah, let's see what happens. It's deterministic, so it's new data, but the face is not inline, and it takes some time until that goes down, but only the first 100 samples. So let's see, most likely I have done everything correctly, and I was training the neural network on healthy data, and now the neural network trains itself on faulty data, and since it hasn't seen that data for such a long period, only half of the time it has seen faulty data, the reconstruction error should be higher. I think we won that. Even if the value goes down really fast, I think I can relax. Okay, perfect. 10,000 in contrast to 150, and that's a spike. No, we can react on that spike later. That's all. Thanks a lot. If you have questions, you can ask now. Until this guy throws us out.
Sorry.
Yeah, we are in the QA session. No worries. So I'm done. You can ask questions. I'm basically here until I have to leave. Okay.
Thank you.